I'm James.
What's up, everybody? I'm Ed.
Mitch.
Big T.
We're CrossFade.
Our band's been together for about 11 or 12 years.
We were all in rival bands in high school. Three different rival bands, all played Battle of the Bands against each other, and we all respected each other as musicians.
It was kind of a mutual musician kind of relationship. After a while, both of our previous bands, mine and Ed's bands, broke up. We got together right after high school.
We were with an older drummer at that point in time, and we grew for 8 or 9 years, and then Tony came down from Buffalo, and we hooked up with Tony about 6 years ago.
When I came down here, I was hanging out with some friends, and I happened to walk past some warehouses, and I was walking by, and I heard these guys, and I was like, God, listen to that singer. He was talking about Ed, and so I walked over there, and I watched them, and they all had real long hair, and they were just rocking out. It was just amazing. I was blown away by his voice, and he had this big six-string bass, and I started talking to him, and I said, well, I'd like to be in your band. What do you do? And I told him, I just scratch, and I mix, and I do this other stuff, and they're like, well, we don't really, need that kind of thing in our band, but, eventually, I just kept bugging them and bugging them until they finally said, all right, come down and try out some stuff.
When Tony first came into the band, he, back like 8 or 9 years ago, he first started as a percussionist and a backup vocalist. His role in the band kind of started to evolve to be primarily a backup vocalist, but also in the live respect, just to fill in live where we couldn't, because only one guitarist, a bassist, and a drummer.
As the band evolved, my DJ stuff just kind of went with it.
So he started getting a little more into sampling and mixing and DJing and filling in that way. And over the years, he's become quite an accomplished guy live, just making the show so much of a better show by filling up the sound. He's a great performer on stage and a great singer. So, Tony's added, quite a dimension to our band.
Just recently, we acquired James here.
Mr. James.
When I first started with the band, I was given a practice CD with all the tunes that I needed to learn. Listen to it over and over again for a couple of days and came in and started rehearsal. And, the first rehearsal, you had six or seven of the songs down. It just felt natural for me.
What he's not bragging about is that he didn't even play the drums to the songs when he learned them. He spent, 4 or 5 days listening to it nonstop. And we were like, man, I can't believe you learned all those songs. He's like, actually, I hadn't even set up my drums until today. So it was a... Very cool.
When we got James, he inspired us all just to jump out of our caves, man. We all just became better players.
I love you guys, man.
Our hometown is in Columbia, South Carolina, and not too much going on in Columbia. We all grew up there though, except for Tony.
Being in a town like Columbia, which is a good college town, it's got a pretty good rock scene. It's just trying to be a band and trying to get signed, go anywhere besides Columbia or the surrounding places, it doesn't happen. Columbia is just not that kind of town.
Getting our sound out of our hometown was quite a feat for us. Way back in high school, when Mitch and I first got together, we started playing as much as we possibly could around Columbia. We decided around that time that playing in Columbia was not conducive to getting out of Columbia musically. So we decided to really stop playing and just focus on writing music. We spent countless hours at a place called Sound Lab in West Columbia. And there was never enough money to do what we wanted to do. Every time we would go in to record, we'd come back out with something that, we didn't like it. And so we'd go back a week later and try it again. And we soon realized that we just weren't one of those bands that could go in, play, just slap some stuff down and be done with it. So we decided to embark upon this journey of recording our own music, and it took us 2 or 3 years of purchasing equipment, computers and software, and just learning stuff and trial and error.
The album was recorded, the band recorded the album in a basement, did everything themselves.
It was more of a necessity than anything. We just couldn't really afford to just pay so much money and still not come out with something we liked. We could spend that same amount of money for a week in the studio and have all our own stuff and spend as much time as we ever needed to on it. And that way you can sit there, you can mull over the same song for 6 months, and you know, when you finally get it, you know it's there. That feeling of accomplishment, being able to do it yourself, has just made all the difference in the world to us.
And I can remember doing 3 months of just, maybe even 4 months of just steady going over to Ed's house like 3 and 4 nights a week, the whole band, and just going over these songs again and again and again, and every little tiny piece, you know, and Ed would be just like, the room would be kind of dark and there's Ed behind the computer, you know, and we're all like standing around. It's just like, it's a, kind of a cool scene, but you know, Ed's really the genius behind all that because he's, you know, the computer whiz. So, I mean, it didn't take long. It took a while to get it going, but it didn't take long because he already had the experience with the computers.
You know, the studio that we made was in my house, so I had the luxury of having all that at my disposal 24 hours a day. Didn't have a job, just kind of wake up, go to the studio, write, record.
Most of the songs actually start, on this album, started acoustically. The studio was at my house, so a lot of times I'd be sitting around with an acoustic guitar and get an idea and just go into the studio and just start writing. Get kind of a skeleton of a song, verses, choruses, and melodies and lyrics, that kind of stuff. I get the song to a point to where the rest of the guys can kind of digest it, figure out where it should go from there, and then we'll all get together, and from there, you know, it'll become a completely different beast. We'll just sit around for days and just lock ourselves in that room and just go at it.
So you found out today your life's not the same, not quite as perfect as it was yesterday, when you were just getting in the groove. Now you're faced with something new. I know it hurts and I know you feel torn, but you never gave up this easily before. So why do you choose today to have it all right? Well, it's not so bad, y'all. Together we all fall. Just as long as we get up, we'll stand tall. We shouldn't waste another day thinking about the things that we forgot to say. I'm hitting back, y'all, kicking these four walls just as hard as I can till I can't crawl. I won't waste another day with all these silly things in my brain.
There's no giving up now.
Do you really wanna give this all away? Can't you ever see things in a different way someday?
Don't give it up now.
Such a beautiful thing to throw away. You should think.
I remember sitting down one day and in the middle of writing No Giving Up and thinking about how this was long before we had any prospects of getting a record deal. And for me personally, I was just one of those holes, just thinking, what the hell am I doing? But then I soon realized that, you know, I'm still here doing what I love. I've got the ability to, even though I'm working every day, I've got the ability to come home and do what I love to do. So I kind of got off my little pity party and just, you know, there's no giving up.
Do you really want to give this all away? Can't you ever see things in a different way someday?
For me, I think that it represents the general attitude of the band. You know, we're not going to give up, and we're going to do everything we can to take this as far as we can.
You know, that song, just that one day, I think the whole song was all the lyrics were written just a frenzied passion of, man, just, you know, just step outside of yourself and look at what you got and just take what you got and do the best you can with it, and, you know.
But also, Edward, too, has a way of disappearing when he gets in his songwriting mode. He disappeared for like 3 days. I couldn't get in touch with him. I was trying to get in touch with him about something, and finally he calls me. He says, what do you want, bro? You didn't even call me for 3 days. And he said, but you need to come over here and check this out. And this is when he started to write Cold. And he, you know, I remember him sitting on his pool table and showing me this song, and I thought to myself, wow, that's just amazing, you know what I mean? And then a couple of days later, he comes to practice with an actual CD of the song written, you know, and it had the bass line, the guitar, you know, everything there, you know, for us to hear. And, you know, he says, oh, what do you guys think about this? And we were all just...
We said it sucked.
Yeah, we did say it sucked. But that's what he does. This is how this guy is. He'll disappear like that, but when he comes out of his hiding, he comes out with a product that's just like, you're like, how did you do that, man? Well, it started out on the toilet and it ended up in the living room, and I got to the bedroom, and then I'm sorry I didn't answer your calls for 3 days. I thought, I'm so sorry that you thought I was dead, but.
He's sorry for the way he is.
He's sorry for the way I am. That's truly, truly true there.
What I really meant to say is I'm sorry for the way I am. I never meant to be so cold. Never meant to be so cold. I really
You guys remember when we shot that video for Cold?
Yeah. That was kind of weird in the living room jamming and playing, but after a while it was,
It was actually very cool, and the lighting that they did in it was amazing.
Yeah, the lights coming through the window. And the, of course, you know, Bo Garrett. Good God.
Nice girl.
Nice girl.
Her boyfriend was really nice, too.
Yeah, and her dog.
And her dog, too. She had her boyfriend and her dog with her.
She must have been scared of us, man, bringing her boyfriend and her dog to this shoot.
She might have been.
I guess the concept of the video is the singer Ed apologizing to the girl in the video, about, I guess, leaving her behind for the band.
A lot of the songs that I had written lyrically, I'll look back on like 3-4 months or 2 years, look back on and say, okay, that's what was going on in my head, you know, because I don't really, it just comes out. I don't know that it's not intentional. It's not, okay, I'm going to sit down and write about this day. And sometimes you don't know really where it comes from because, you know, a lot of the times you're, whether it's your hurt or somebody else's, you just don't see it. You feel it, but you don't know why it's there. And, you know, like the song Colors, there were a few people in my life that I wanted to say, look, you know, you've got to see what's going on around you and realize that everything that you're doing is bad for you and everything that you're doing is just driving you down into a hole.
You know, they had great lives and they kind of threw it away and they just did not make what they could have made out of their lives, just making mistakes, just living their life completely the wrong way that they had the opportunity otherwise to do so. And Colors is a lot about that, just about not shining the colors that you got.
I see now that I wrote that song back then for that person, and just had no idea at the time that's why I wrote the song. Relationship with our fans is the most cherished thing to us because it's taken us so long to get our music out to the people, which, you know, we never really wanted to be this big live band. We just wanted to get our music out to the people. And knowing that we had the chance to do that and that people do have it, when we have the chance to talk with the fans, to meet the fans, it's like, it's whatever we can do to take that time, we will take it. After the shows, until the last person's gone, we will stay out and just meet as many of them as we can, talk with as many of them as we can. And, you know, every night, that's what gives us our energy for the next day, man. It's you know, the show is great, but when we get that connection with the people, you know, you when we're playing live, we see them singing the songs, but to talk to them and hear the stories about how they like the music, it just makes it all worthwhile for us. And we want to keep that going as long as we can.
I had this young lady and her mother come up to me at the show, and I guess the young lady had gone through a lot of emotional distress over her father dying, and he was a musician as well, so she had painted us a picture, and it's a red background with a broken acoustic guitar, and it's broken and shattered, and the strings are hanging down and all that, and she said that Cold and Dead Skin made her just get through these really tough times about losing her father, and then she feels like the broken guitar is a symbol of her father dying and how it broke her heart for him to die, and that our songs helped her and her mother through that, you know, and it's very touching. And I have the picture hanging up in my living room, which, you know, I was blown away by that someone could actually, you know, go through a really hard time like that and actually come out good, you know, through our songs, you know. And
we get a lot of, you know, everywhere we go, we get stories, mainly of Cold so far, because it's really the main one that people are hearing and identifying with at this point in time. But just so many different stories, people getting back together, people splitting up. It's just amazing to find that our song can be the backdrop to so many people's problems and lives, and that they take it in like that. And that's just really cool, man, just to know that people find that in your music.
Columbia's it's just become such a great town for us. Just our fans at home are the greatest fans ever. And our radio station at home is
Dave Farrell, 93.5.
You never get that kind of love in your hometown.
In studio with me right now, the guys from CrossFade. You guys got to be excited. It's a big day. There's cameras following you around. You've become rock stars.
Yeah, man.
Yeah. Isn't that killer, man? See, there it is.
Living awesome, man. That is awesome.
Columbia, South Carolina absolutely loves you guys. Just tell me what it's like when you go out of town and there's people who know every last note to your record that you've never met in your entire life. How weird is that for you guys?
It's orgasmic.
You guys have supported us for so long, and thank you so much for it. So this is for you guys.
Say
there are a lot of ways we keep in touch with our fans. You know, after the shows, we'll stay around the entire show. We do have an email address on our website that we try desperately to keep up with. It's gotten a lot harder over the past few months. We used to get like 10 emails a day. Now we get, you know, a couple of hundred a day. So it's getting a little harder to go through the emails, but we're still trying to do that. And MySpace.com, there's a CrossFade page there, which is a really good place for all the people to get together and talk about CrossFade and to get in touch with us. The message boards, of course. Mitch's phone number is 803.
Funny.
That's funny.
No, really, my number.